Oh yeah, hello everybody. We have fun here. This is the Common Good Radio Show brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission, and we have another amazing show for you today. We have Patrick Lopez with MPG Automotive, a Common Good favorite here in studio with us. And then we have, I think safe to say, no offense to Patrick, but our very favorite on the Common Good Radio Show, we have Dr. J on today.
Yeah, man. That's going to be fun.
Give us some tips on how to make our way into college, how to get through college when we get into college, and what to do with it once you get out of it. So, actually, speaking of which, we should probably have you on that show, on the Making College Come True show one day, Patrick.
Because that would be cool. Yeah.
Yeah, it would be definitely cool to hear your experience on, why you chose college, what it was like going to college.
Yeah, that's great.
And obviously all the amazing things you've done with it since getting out of it, which is like a cool story that we talk about on Making College Come True, that I think it's, you're kind of one of the guys that's, didn't have to worry about that. Is like a lot of kids that go to TIA, Tucson International Academy, their parents didn't tell them growing up, you're going to go to college, or this is what your future looks like. Where I'm guessing you, me, people that we grew up with, we did.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And because of that, we were able to take it somewhere. And also a big story is like a lot of kids' families discourage them going to school because they don't want them to leave the household. They're a big part of taking care of their household, and they don't want them to leave. But I'm guessing with your family, they said, hey, the very opposite. So, showing that how big a part your family is in that experience.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, not to get off topic, but really we do the same thing when we made the gap class, right? Mm-hmm. We've talked about that before. Mm-hmm. My sister went to college as well for a background in more behavioral sciences. Mm-hmm. And really I thought about it from an economic perspective, but she brought it to light that your situation, your family, your upbringing, where you're at can really make a huge difference in your experience, right? I mean, my father grew up the exact way that you're mentioning, that we need you to be here. We need you to go to the military, do this, do that. You can't be the president, but you can open the door for the president. Mm. That's what he was told. Mm. And he told me, I don't care. You can be the president. You go to school, college is almost non-negotiable from the sense that you're more than capable of it. And so, you're right. I mean, it's all about how you were told what you could be, right?
Yeah.
That can make it difficult for you otherwise. So.
For sure.
That's cool, man. Good stuff.
Awesome. Well, we're going to do what we do this show every show, and we're going to give grace to a very loving father that has definitely blessed everybody in this studio, and including our engineer Tom in there who he keeps telling me he's almost 80. I don't believe him. He only looks 55.
Really?
That just shows
he's not.
One of the many blessings that come around us. But we're going to put our father first and thank him this week. We're going to go with the Lord's Prayer, and it goes a little something like this. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, yes. So, as we got you listening audience, you got a little taster of the good man, Mr. Patrick Lopez, in studio with us. But let me officially thank you for being here with us, Patrick.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I always love it here.
Yeah, amen. Absolutely. And you, I think the big thing that I definitely have been loving lately is like you've really been bringing some serious knowledge, particularly putting some pennies, putting some change back into people's pockets on like the simplest things. I mean, the thing that I really love about what you bring is just like, most people have a car. Most people are, doing these things. Most people, have to do these things if they, either for routine maintenance or to save, but most people don't even know.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, look, 90% of the battle is just bringing it to your attention. And the great thing is we're all responsible adults or teenagers, whoever's driving, right? Mm-hmm. And if you just make a small change, it can lead to hundreds of dollars per year. So. Mm-hmm. And again, it's always been with the focus of things that I can help you with as having automotive shops around town, but more importantly, things that you can do, maybe just something, a change in your routine that could save you money that you don't need to do anything other than just make that mindset change. So.
Yeah.
You know, I'm talking about like saying like saving money, like, you know, have you seen the gas prices like increasing?
Since the last time he was here.
Now it's three. Yeah.
I know. It's wild.
Yeah. Hey, sometimes, you know, I'm not saying it's lucky because I don't like high gas prices, but we've really been feeling that in our industry, right? That that we're noticing that these gas prices are fluctuating, right? We just depending on what's going on in the marketplace, they go up, they go down, right? But when they go up, it starts affecting us more, right? I think we've all seen those videos of people complaining at the gas pump that now it's $70-$80 to fill up their their vehicle, and
yeah,
it's no fun when you have to hit that, right? And so really the focus for the last week, right, we talked about air filters, PSI, excessive weight, and Andres, you weren't here, but it wasn't about COVID weight, it was about vehicle weight. but no, you know, those little things like that can save you money throughout the year. And as gas price keeps going up and up and up, and hopefully it stops. I really want it to stay at the $3 level or less, right? That's that seems to be okay, or at least better on our pocketbooks. Then the higher it goes, the more it hits us, the less, you know, our efficient our vehicles are. So
when you're saying like, you know, to save money, like you mentioned a few things there that you need to do and keep maintaining those. What are those few things for saving gas? Like,
yeah. So I know we had previously talked about air filters and so on, and, but, you know, I wanted to come with some new stuff. So that way, you know, we can build upon what we had already talked about. And really, I wanted to start off with vehicle idling. Now that people are going back to school, and idling just means sitting in your car while it's running and it's not moving anymore. I don't want it to be an industry term, but I think some people do understand that. But again, so if you're in the parent pickup line, you're waiting for your kid and your vehicle's running, you're 100% lost in fuel economy, right? If your tank is $50, well, you know, if you just keep idling over time, it builds up and you can be losing that much money over the course of a month or a few months. That's hundreds of dollars a year, right? So parent pickup line, you know, getting groceries, you decide to wait in the car. Uber, Lyft drivers, right? They idle all the time waiting for their rides. So idling can be a huge problem, and it's something that you don't have to go to any expert. You just kind of have to be cognizant and aware of if you're not moving, you're not getting fuel economy. And if your vehicle's running, then you're eating up gas. And as gas prices continue to increase, it's going to cost you more money just to sit there.
Well, I'm gonna pick up this question when we get back, but I've always heard like when you restart the car, it uses extra gas or whatever, but I'm not going to have you answer that yet. Let's wait till we get back from the break. This is the Common Good Radio Show brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. That's Patrick Lopez with MPG Automotive Services in studio with us. Have Andreas tell you something about it. I believe in myself before we leave real quick.
Yeah, anybody that's interested in taking their life to the next level, who wants to set a strategy for that big vision, that big goal that you desire, hit me up. I will help you overcome your fears, get that strategy ready, and start taking action. Send me an email at ibelievecal@gmail.com.
Brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. I'm Pastor John McClain here with my best buddy, guy who almost see every day of the week, like happenstantially, Andreas Ruiz with I Believe in Myself Coaching. I guess like in a way, you're kind of like coaching me almost every day of the week now, huh?
Yeah, man, I'm coaching you on that jump shot.
Good. Nice. Yeah. Well, if anything, I should be coaching you on that jump shot, because the last time we played, somebody won two games of horse.
I know.
Hello.
I know. Yeah.
That was a good game. You actually surprised me. You are a much better shot than I gave you credit for.
Thanks,
so
appreciate it.
I'll never be slacking on you. I'll never be underestimating you playing a game. Never. And speaking of another guy who looks like he has a good jump shot, we got Patrick Lopez in studio with us with MPG Automotive Services. Thank you once again, brother.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. I did used to play, so we'll have to.
I can see that.
Okay, we'll have to all get
together. Yeah, the three of us. Yeah, it'd be
great.
Maybe
you can meet us, yeah.
Sure.
The YMCA. Yeah, well,
yeah, that's what we do. Me and Andreas meet every Monday, usually 10 or 11. This week we met at the downtown YMCA and just played a little ball while we kind of had a brainstorming session. So
that's good.
Yeah, man. Yeah, sure. It was fun. Like usually we meet at the Arizona Sands Club and we sit down and we have like a little computer or a pen and pad and kind of take notes. But this was a different approach. And I liked it though.
It was fun.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a good time.
Yeah.
But before we went into the break, I asked you the question, like I've always been under the impression that when like you're saying, when I'm waiting for my kid after school, you know, I'd just keep my car idling rather than turn it off and back on, because when I turn it back on, I'm going to use this absorbent amount of gas, is what I've always been taught. What, you know, teach me better, please.
Well, look, I mean, it's a double-edged sword in the sense that, you know, we idle when we're at a stop sign, right? Mm-hmm. When we're at a stoplight. Mm-hmm. So you don't turn your car off then, mm-hmm. right? But what you'll notice is these manufacturers have now done that auto off. Have you seen that? You come up to a stoplight and all of a sudden the vehicle goes into mm-hmm. using a few less pistons.
Mm-hmm.
And because the engine didn't fully stop, it's still keeping the fuel going. It's not like that initial burst.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the shorter answer is it light switches are the same way. When you flip on and off a light, the power that it takes there puts more wear on the light and all that good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there is a cost to that, right? Mm-hmm. But if you're going to be sitting for 30 minutes, the cost of turning your car off for mm-hmm. 30 minutes and turning it back on 30 minutes later mm-hmm. is way, way less than that 30 minutes of time just sitting there and your full engine revving, taking up all that fuel to keep it going. So mm-hmm. so if it's a quick break, if it's a minute, you know, I'm only going to be here for a minute, idling may not make sense. Mm-hmm. But if you know, look, 25 minutes, 30 minutes, maybe an hour if you didn't time it well. Well, then that's a lot of fuel that you're going to be eating through mm-hmm. and not going anywhere.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. I'm going to talk to my wife. She idles for like 30, 40 minutes. I'm
We used to have a tow company. And so when we did, the big cost there was them sitting waiting for the next job.
Mm.
And so idling was our number one expense. And so we've seen it in our real life example on the business side. And so getting to share that with your audience who may be listening to this in a car idling right now, you know, just a good, you know, thought to, hey, if I'm going to be here for a while and I can sit in here without the car on, then let's try to save some money.
Mm. Just roll down the windows, turn off the engine, just relax.
See, hey, as the weather gets better.
Yeah, I know. Right now, I can't do that. Good stuff, man.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yep.
And then I know... I have on my run sheet here that wheel alignment is a big thing.
You know, we talked about last time about a couple things that help. And so I really wanted to bring up wheel alignments. It's something that we think wheel alignments are really just how our vehicle goes straight down the road, right?
Mm.
I think, you know, we've all heard that not having your wheels aligned can cause wear on your tires, right?
Mm-hmm.
It also causes wear on your suspension. But one thing that we don't think about is anytime you have more road friction, anytime you have a longer path to go because you're always having to fight the steering wheel, you're wasting fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And it may seem microscopic, but it can be up to 10%.
Interesting.
Up to 10% of your fuel economy lost just by fighting a steering wheel, right? And on top of that, you got your tire wear, you got suspension components getting wear on them as well. So, yeah, I wanted to mention that because that's something that, you know, the real main thing there is to be cognizant of it.
Mm-hmm.
If you're fighting the steering wheel, there's a cost to that on your vehicle, on your fuel economy, which means on your pocketbook, right? So coming in and getting an alignment check or getting an alignment yearly can save you money on tires, suspension, and at the fuel pump quite drastically.
Good stuff. Yeah. And I never thought about that, but it does make a lot of sense if you're kind of steering a little bit to the left. You're not going forward. You're going to the side. So... interesting, man. Like, it does make sense. And okay, so
Excess friction. I think we talked about that in the past too, right? When we said excess weight, any excess drag, excess friction, it's going to make things more difficult.
Yeah, I definitely paid attention when you said the thing about the extra weight too. And I've been like, all my vehicles, they're cleared out now. Like, even the dirt, I don't let it hang around anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it just it weighs too much. And then another thing that I'm seeing here that I'm really interested in hearing about the proper intervals when it comes to oil changes, which when I was in Iraq, and this is a short story, I put 500,000 miles on the vehicle on the Humvee that I drove in Iraq.
Yep.
And we changed the oil maybe six times that whole entire time.
Yep.
You know, that I put those 500,000 miles on it. So I started getting in my head, maybe you don't need to do the oil change, blah, 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 blah. Teach me right, please.
Well, again, it goes back to that excess drag, excess friction, right? When when the oil heats up, it starts breaking down. It gets more difficult for the engine to process it, right?
Mm-hmm.
That has a cost to fuel economy because the engine isn't running as efficiently. It's not burning up the fuel the way that it needs to. That can be even more. That can be like a 12-15% reduction on fuel economy for not changing your oil at intervals that it needs to be done. One common myth has always been the 3,000 miles myth, right? Mm-hmm. Some vehicles are still that way, but now the way that engine oil coolers work and these manufacturers are making these engines better, you really have to go check your owner's manual to see when it's due, or go to any of our locations. I mean, we subscribe to all those manufacturers, so we know what they're expecting, right? If your vehicle is supposed to be done at 5,000 miles, then we're going to tell you 5,000, not 3,000, because that's when it's due. But there's nothing wrong with changing the oil more regularly. And, you know, that's why we offer those vehicle maintenance plans. We had talked about those in the past, but it's a way to budget on a monthly basis for when you need those oil changes. So you pay a monthly fee and you get, you know, a certain number of oil changes in a year and you don't have to think about it. You know, we're going to give you a call and let you know, hey, it's time to come in, or you say, hey, it's been a few months. You call us and say, hey, can I come on in? And when we get you going, because you don't have to worry about that one-time payment for the oil change. You just say, hey, I know it's about time. Let me call MPG. I have the plan. I'm going to come on in, and they're going to take care of it for me. And it's a great way for people to budget, but it's also a great way for them to save at the pump, because they're getting that consistency of the renewed oil in that system, letting it operate as it's supposed to with less friction and so on. So.
Nice. Yeah. Well, thank you, Patrick, for coming on the show with us. That's Patrick Lopez with MPG Automotive Services.
Yeah, thank you for having me. And like I said, anything I can give the audience to save some money at the pump. Hopefully gas prices settle down, but in the case that they don't, we all can take a look at what we can do to help our pocketbooks, right?
Definitely. And how can they contact you in case they have any questions, or they'd like to come in for, you know, oil change, wheel alignment, or any of these great services you have?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, our Facebook page is great, MPG Automotive Services on Facebook, or mpgautomotiveservices.com. They can absolutely schedule an appointment or reach us there.
Nice.
Wonderful. Good stuff, man.
That's Patrick Lopez of MPG Automotive Services. It's the Common Good Radio Show, brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. If you haven't been to 1118 North Jones Boulevard and checked out Veteran Thrift, please do. All the proceeds go to our homeless veteran transition program, Veteran Rescue Mission, to help us better shelter and help connect veterans with housing. The Common Good Radio Show, highlighting the good in our community, brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. I'm Pastor John McClain, here with Mr. Andreas Ruiz, the most motivational motivator that you could ask for with I Believe in Myself coaching.
Yeah, man. And we have Dr. J.
You got now Dr. J in the house.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Been a while.
It's been a while. Yeah.
The trio.
Yeah. With Dr. J here, I feel like we got the team ready.
There we go.
Yeah, man. People are in trouble with us around. So this is like the fundamental pieces of our mastermind here.
Yes.
That's right. There's dynamic duos, but there's also triumphant trios.
Ooh,
that's
us. I like that one.
That's us.
We're definitely heard that one. Trio. Yeah,
I like that.
I want to think with the three of us, there's nothing that we couldn't handle.
Oh, 100%.
It's always good when we get together. It's just the energy.
This is fun. We just sit here just joke all day long.
I'm excited.
Okay, but the for those who don't know, that's as I would say at the beginning of every Making College Come True radio show, we have the superintendent of Tucson International Academy, a former Tucson Unified School District educator, the author of the book, Making College Come True, 10 Keys to Success, and I believe the newest talk radio show host in the fair city of Tucson. She goes by the name of Dr. Jennifer Herrera.
Yes.
Welcome.
Yeah. But us cool kids, or the cool kids at TIA, call her Dr. J.
Yes.
The Dr. J. And her like real close friends, which I think I've only called her this a couple times just because I have just so much love and respect for her. Call her Jennifer.
Yes.
Yeah. Same
name. That is my name.
It sounds weird when I say it. I don't know.
I like Jennifer.
Dr.
I like
J so much.
I like
it.
Thank you. Thank you.
But those who have never heard Dr. J before and never heard of Tucson International Academy, Dr. J, please tell us, what is Tucson International Academy?
Well, Tucson International Academy is definitely a life-changing place.
Okay.
It is a place where we, our goal anyway, is to help anyone who is maybe struggling, stuck in some sort of rut of poverty and would like to look at colleges as a way of getting out. Mm. We are the answer to that question. Mm. We are four separate schools four different locations, kinder through 12th grade at each location, and we offer a college prep program. And not only do we get you into college prep, but we'll develop you as a leader, and we will give you experiences that will prepare you for life.
Right.
So we do some of that by our business program, which is geared around the kids starting their own businesses and running them, and some of them actually make money. It's also international trips around the world. We give them an opportunity to raise money and to go on those. Not a lot of them are able to go, but by sending someone from your school, when they come back, they present about it, and so they share it. So it's like the whole school went. And we go all over the world, China, Japan, Australia, Spain, Italy, France, England, Mexico. We haven't been to Canada yet, but might not be for a while since COVID thing rules. But but we continue to travel, and we will go again, I'm sure. But our next trip is scheduled actually for this March to Greece.
Very
nice. So looking forward to that. And so we are definitely going to help kids get the academics they need to conquer any goal they need, pass any test they need. That is easy for us because that's what we do. We're professional educators, K-12. And then on top of that, we do try to offer these different experiences. And one of the experiences that we recently did is 16 de septiembre. We have a Spanish and a Chinese program. The Spanish program is obvious because Mexico's 45 minutes away. So for us to celebrate Mexico's Independence Day makes sense because you want your neighbors, your neighboring countries to share some values, and the value of freedom is very high. So we share that with Mexico. We celebrate it. We have folkloric dancing. The kids say and do things in Spanish using their either their native language or their second language that they have learned. But, you know, Spanish, it's great to be bilingual.
Yeah.
And ours, we hope, become trilingual with our Mandarin Chinese program.
Nice. That's super cool. Like Spanish, English, Mandarin.
I mean, yeah, it's fun.
You really don't hear that anywhere else.
Starting your own business. Yeah. I mean, that's pretty cool too. I got the opportunity to witness that when I went to go speak one time. I even bought something off of one of the kids who made some type of oil with lavender and all this stuff. And I saw it and I was like, man, what is this stuff? I kind of want one of these. And they're like, yeah, well, you can get one. Okay, well, let me get one. So,
it
was really cool to see that experienced with the youth, to be able to even know like how to start a business. Maybe they were the first to ever start their own business. Then they were, what, 14, 15 years old?
Exactly. Yeah.
And I think that's just so important for you to know that, hey, you can be a business owner, and you're the example of you can do it.
You can do it. I mean, I think everyone in the leadership of TIA has a second, like, side job we do just because we're curious. We're curious, like, oh, how does this work? Ooh, what could I make if I do this as well? You know, a little coaching, or I did coaching for a while on the side. I've done lots of pyramid type businesses, like where you're selling coffee or you're selling oils or, and we like some of the products, right? And
we learn
a lot about, like, what's possible. And so I enjoy that. Putting on events. I mean, we should be event planners. That should be our side business,
because
we do a lot of them, and we have a nice team put together. So, you know, it's just fun. By doing that, we're more than educators. We're able to prepare them for life. You know, we're giving them career options. We have a huge career fair that is only for TIA students, and we have like 15 agencies of the police department come. You know, including marshals. You know, that are intern. You know, they're national. We have businesses from all over. I can't even begin to say them all. But, I mean, we have architects. We have builders. We have media people who come and have a booth. So you guys have to have a booth this year.
Yeah.
Both of you are business owners. That's who we attract. That's who we like to hang around. And to me, I think that's what gives hope for the next generations, that they can do fun things that they enjoy and that they can actually make money from it. Just like our feature book, right?
Yeah.
How to have a radio show and make money.
Yeah, I
can't wait for that to come out. I'm really excited. I have so much. I can't wait for our next meeting.
It's coming together nicely. I mean, and I think it's just where I think the inspiration for that, and we're about to go to break, so I'll say this as we go to break, is kind of like where we were at the beginning of, I guess, last year.
It's almost gonna be 2 years.
Yeah.
Man. Dang.
Where it was just like, we either get comfortable or we get comfortable with being uncomfortable. And I think that's where we're at right now, is we're like, okay, let's get comfortable with being uncomfortable. And let's make some amazing things happen. So
right on.
I'm happy to do that with you guys.
Me too.
So this is the Common Good Radio Show brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. That beautiful voice you hear is Dr. Jennifer Herrera with Tucson International Academy. That's going to be joining us here. You guys sit right there. Brought to you by Veteran Rescue Mission. And speaking of the good in our community that we're highlighting, we got Dr. Jennifer Herrera with Tucson International Academy here in studio with us.
Woohoo!
Talking about the good coming out of there. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And I got Andreas Ruiz, as usual, with I Believe in Myself here to hold me up whenever I run out of things to say and to give me positive energy when I'm not feeling so positive.
Thank you. And you know what? Speaking of positive, what I wanted to mention about Jennifer was the reason why these people are thinking outside of the box and are thinking about maybe starting their own business, maybe even people that work there, that because you showed them that it's like that 4-minute mile. Once Roger Bannister did it, everybody else was doing it. Once you see somebody doing it, you're like, maybe I could do it. Like for me, when I saw Les Brown having high school diploma and then like doing what he was doing, I was like, if he can do it, then I can do it. And
absolutely,
when they see you doing what you're doing, you inspire people to go to college. I've seen some of the teachers that are going to college because of you. You push them, and that's cool because they're probably like, oh, you know, I don't want to do this. And you
put
Yeah. But then they do it and they're like, they feel accomplished. And it had not been for you, they wouldn't be where they're at, you know? So like, how do you feel that that has helped you and your people because of your influence on them to influence the rest of the people around them? Like, how do you feel that has helped them?
Well, I mean, I'm a big believer in lead by example. So I have trouble asking people to do things that I'm not willing to do or that I'm not able to do unless it's not in my skill set, you know, which there's some things that, you know, you hire people to help you spread the word about your company. You hire people to do, you know, the construction work. But like, as far as leading and anything education, you know, I want to be the best teacher in TIA. And all the time I'll tell them, I'm the best teacher here. Huh. So you want to argue with me? Have me come to your class. I'll fix your problem. Because they act like it's so hard. And I'm like, look, I haven't even taught in years on a consistent basis. But I bet you anything, I can turn your class around in 3 days. And sometimes they take me up on the challenge. And it's always a thrill for me because I'm like, oh, I can't wait, because for me it's so easy because I've done it forever. And it's like any discipline problem, any curriculum problem, any, you know, problem in communicating effectively with parents, I can usually help them conquer that. I haven't had an incident yet where I wasn't able to help solve the problem. And then say I couldn't solve the problem, well, I got resources. I got you who can help people motivate and to feel like step into their greatness. I have you who has changed laws. Come on. I mean, it's like, wow. I mean, I have resources, so I can always resource it if I myself can't do it. And so that's what I think is fun, is that I am kind of a average Joe. Like in high school, I had to work hard to get A's. And because I didn't always want to work hard, I didn't always get straight A's. So, you know, it's not like I was a super gifted, smart person. I had to work for everything. And I was younger, like a whole year younger than everyone in my class. So it always felt like I was a day late and a penny short, you know?
You know, when you say that about resources and how you use the resources, why do you feel people don't use the resources around them?
And I think some of it's pride. I think some of it's lack of confidence in that they're going to try to help me and I'm still going to fail. But I believe in setting people up for success. So I know certain things, if I help establish certain things, like right now we're working on getting our kids to turn in their cell phones at the beginning of the day, because if they don't, then they're using them during the day. That's disruptive. And it's also, it just says, I don't want to follow your rules. And I think that that's a bad thing to let kids get into that habit. So we're trying to solve the problem. How can we motivate them to be proactive and to do it on their own without us having to be naggy mommy? You know, we're not their moms. You know, you're coming to our school. And so these are the rules of coming here, and you got to turn your phone in. And I'm kind of curious to see how this works out, because I'm not going to step in and just solve the problem, even though I could. But I don't want to. I want them to figure it out, and I want them to work it. But I'm not going to just leave them hanging. I'm going to have good conversations. I'm going to have, like, strategy sessions with the leaders, strategy sessions with the student leaders as well. And then let them come up with the what they think they should do about it and why it's important, and then let them solve it. And then they're going to feel so empowered. It's like, why was I so addicted to my phone? Like, that's what we're already hearing. Mm-hmm. In two of the four schools, it's like two of them have no problem turning their phones in there. It's like, I don't know why. God, it's a relief. I don't have to hear so-and-so with her stupid ideas, you know? So even the kids are getting it. And so when we can empower adults and kids to solve a silly problem, well, it's not actually silly. I mean, phones are like...
It's something huge. Pretty big. Robin Sharma, great motivational speaker, he says that for every time that you get interrupted, it takes you 11 to 21 minutes to get back into laser focus.
So you can imagine
one text, and then you get back into the focus, and then ding. And then right now, kids are spending 8 to 12 hours a day on their phone. So you can imagine you're spending 8 hours of sleep. So, you know, let's say you live up to the age of 75. You spend 25 years of your life sleeping, 25 years of your life on the phone, and then the other 25 years working, going to the bathroom, taking a shower, eating. When did you actually really live? You know, imagine 25 years of your life on the phone.
That just sounds crazy, right?
Yeah, it sounds crazy, but when you think about it, it's
true.
8 hours a day is 1/3 of your life.
Yep.
And then when you're sleeping, I mean, you're really not doing anything for the world. So you're just sleeping. So 2/3 of your life, you're just spending doing nothing really productive. So
it's not an encouragement.
But I like that idea because... The phone, man, and it's not just kids, it's adults, you know, that can get it really into it. So, yeah, it's something that I think that is it's a great idea. And, you know, I'm looking forward to seeing what happens with that.
Me too. Well, I'll keep you informed because
for sure.
That's a simple thing, but it is something like some schools will just give up. They don't want to hear the parents because the parents can push back hard and you go, God, why is this parent not encouraging their child to turn in their phone? Guess what? The parent probably doesn't turn their phone in at work either.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're trying to work and text and, you know, and wow, you know, I think we've got a little values collision there because my value is that you're fully present. And when you got that thing on and you're distracted by it, you are not fully present and you're not going to do your best work and you're not going to contribute at the highest level. And that's what I think life is about. But then see, that's a philosophical statement. Some people value being everyone's little go-to for everything. And that's how they feel powerful, that people wanted their 2 cents, their like, their thumb up, their, you know, so.
That's a big thing that a lot of kids are struggling with right now, that they want the likes, they want the comments, and they really take stuff personally. Sometimes if somebody puts a ha ha on their post and then they say, why are they laughing at my post? And sometimes people just accidentally hit the wrong button. And, you know, so social media sometimes has a real big play in it that really could cause conflict. Even like people seeing the red, they read my message and they're not responding. Why are they ignoring me? They're making assumptions. And really, sometimes people just forgot to hit send. I do that a lot. Like sometimes I forgot to hit send. Or sometimes I read the message and I'm like, I'll get back to them right now. I forgot. Like 3 days later, I said, sorry about that.
I meant to send that.
You know what I mean? Like that's when but that's because we're busy. But a lot of people take it personally, especially the youth, since their frontal lobe hasn't been fully developed. Like they still don't comprehend this. They don't understand that. They think that they're being ignored.
Exactly.
So, you know, the phone, I'm telling you, it is something that is kind of like causing a lot of conflict, not only with kids, but all over the world. And I think that, I don't know, that something has to be done about it, but I mean, we'll see where that goes, honestly.
Man, it's a gift to turn it off. I mean, everybody knows, you know, that works with me. I just don't do email because if you respond to every email, to be honest, because of the cell phone and because of texting, by the time I finally respond to an email, that was 2 days old.
Yeah.
And so then I just confuse everybody because I responded, but they already solved that problem. But now they're like, wait, was there another problem that we don't know about? Because she is the boss. You know, so I just quit doing email. I said, look, you guys are going to have to call me and then you're going to have to tell me I wrote something in email. Can you respond in 2 hours? And I can say yes or no. And if it's a no, it just means they need to re-hit me up later and let me know if it went through. But I mean, isn't that silly that we have to like plan, you know, when you can talk and how to respond? And oh, geez, but that's how fast everything is. It's just,
oh my goodness, super fast.
And instant. And everybody expects instant. And I'm like, you know what? We need to be realistic. Everything doesn't have to be instant. Let's just find our groove and find our, what do you call it? Like our systems and our timing and our way that we do things and then do that well. And then once everybody understands it, we don't have to feel so rushed. We're not going to miss something because we were trying to hurry up. We're not going to sound angry when we didn't mean to because we're just trying to hurry up and respond. We're going to be appropriate and we're going to think things through. Boy, that's a novel concept these days.
Remember that time and space 20 years ago when we didn't have cell phones.
I know.
You guys remember that?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm actually old enough that, yeah, I remember. Yeah.
So, I remember having the brick phone. It's like that big old brick phone.
So hearing that you're putting devices in play at your school that kind of takes that phone away. Because, like, for example, and we have probably a minute, we have to get out of here. My 14-year-old, his mother and I have decided we're going to hold on to his phone until he's 15.
Mm. That's a great idea, I think. Because thumbs up.
What was happening, it seems like, in connection with that cell phone was he was just trying so hard to be an adult, trying so hard to grow up and do stuff that, you know, older teenagers would do because he had a cell phone, you know, because he had the access that those older people would have.
Influence on the kids.
Mm-hmm. And they just think that, okay, so I got a cell phone. That means I have to get a girlfriend. That means we got to go hang out and go on dates and all this other stuff. And I'm like, dude, you're 14.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, that's a little early.
that's beautiful that, you know, that's one of many things that you do at TIA that is just like changing the culture, changing community, changing people's families. So thank you for that.
I hope so. That's who we want to invite even to come to TIA, is those who want that difference, because we're not the public school. We are a public school, but we're not the big large district where things slide a lot more. If you don't want accountability, then don't come to our school. But accountability, in my opinion, gentle, like supportive accountability, man, that's the ticket to anything you want in life. Then you create the life you dreamed of.
Absolutely. Yeah. I love that.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, as always, Dr. J, for coming on.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And how can people contact you, you know, if they want to get in touch with your school or join your school? What's the best way for them?
Well, the best way is to call and get a tour. But while you're waiting to set up that tour, you should just apply. It's not really apply. It's just ask for admission. And it's at www.TucsonInternationalAcademy, all spelled out, .com. And call 792-3255. That's the quickest way.
Love it. 792-3255. That's Tucson International Academy. Thank you so much, Dr. J, for joining.